Welcome to another edition of AV Rant. I'm Tom Andrea, Associate Editor of Audioholics, and I'm here with
Rob H.
and Austin Pond.
All Hello, right. Austin!
Yay. The whole crew is here. Austin is on board.
Yep, it was hopefully going to happen last week, but didn't happen despite Austin's Herculean efforts to be here. But we're very happy to have him on the podcast this week. We've been looking forward to having our producer show up on the show with us. And the show is AV Rant. It's your home theater and AV questions answered. So going to have a good show today, I think.
Yeah, welcome, Austin. Thanks for showing up.
Oh, yeah.
All right, so this is AV Rant. In order to get your questions answered, all you have to do is ask them. You ask them by emailing us. You can email rob@avrant.com, tom@avrant.com, or you can email Austin at question@avrant.com. Preferably all three. Austin puts together all of our question lists for the week. Assists, if not, does it almost solely himself.
If you want your question on the show, do make sure you email Austin question@avrant.com. That is a big help.
Yeah, because if you send it to me and I notice that you haven't sent it to Austin, I will forward it to him, but I don't always notice. So like this last week, I was, I just was mass deleting emails because I had too much stuff to do. Now, you can also come to the website, www.avrant.com, or you can leave a comment there. You can go to facebook.com/AVRantPodcast. You can do Twitter. Rob is @FirstReflect. I am AVRant_Tom, and Austin is Austin Pond. It's Austin with an E and not the way I spell it, which is not the right way. So we are back. And it was a good Thanksgiving. I was gone last week, and because I was, Rob just... Time limit be damned.
That's
I'm just
right.
going to keep talking until somebody falls asleep during the podcast.
Who wants to do a hangout after party? Well, only the people who can stay up past midnight on the East Coast. That too.
So, So I'm here. We have fewer questions this week, but we are going to be doing a review. As you can maybe see if you're watching the YouTube stream of this, or watching it later on YouTube, which I apologize for my video quality. We're working on that. I am reviewing the Phaeton, or the... How did you say it? Phiaton?
I say Phiaton, because there's Phiaton. A P-H-I-A, and that, to me, that's
I know,
Phiaton.
I hear you, but I always said Phaeton. Anyways, they're...
Maybe it's Phaeton, because it's like P-H-I, Phi. I don't know.
Could be. It's Sigma Phi, so isn't it P-H-I is Phi? Anyways, the B-T... standing for, of course, Bluetooth, 100NC, and NC stands for, of course, noise canceling. Now, they have this new design that everybody likes these days, a little necklace thing, which I think looks awful. That being said, that's just my personal preference. So if you are like really digging the look and you want some of these, the style, because everybody makes them these days, Phaeton actually put a lot of work into these, a lot more than I expected. Now, I want to do downsides first because there's not that many. The little case right here, this little case thingy that goes around your neck, it's plastic. It's hard plastic, but it's plastic, and it feels sort of rinky-dink, to be honest with you. And some of the other ones I've seen, it seems to be more magnetic, where you put them in there, and it kind of snaps into like a magnet. These have, because these are in-ear monitors, these have like a little hole, like a little post in there that you stick the end of the headphone into it. And it sort of stays in there, kinda. I'm usually one for, I'll get one in there very easily, and the other one I have to struggle with. So that. And the only other thing I'm not totally pleased with about these things is that all the controls are on one side. It's like, why couldn't you put like the volume on one side and then that's not true. There's the play. One of these buttons turns the thing on, and one of these buttons does the play, the stop, pause, answer the call. I haven't quite take enough phone calls to get that memorized yet. I always have to go like, I don't know. I'm just going to press one and see what happens. But on the edge here, there's the volume control, and there's also a little switch for noise canceling. I wish they would have put the switch on the other side so that I'm not having to fumble around for it. It gives a little bit more room for the controls. Those were my downsides.
Now, can you use them in a wired fashion at all, or are they strictly Bluetooth?
You can. In fact, they have this really cool little dealy where you it has like the mini USB or micro USB, whatever it is called, USB port that you charge them with. They have an adapter that goes into a 3.5 millimeter plug, which is really nice, which I thought was a good idea.
And all the batteries and whatnot, I'm assuming, are in that sort of necklace piece that goes around your neck.
Yes, that's the whole idea. And they have different little clips here to make this thing longer or shorter, but it's really nice. The necklace thing is really nice in that you never catch it on anything. You know, I am always catching my cords on stuff, no matter the length or where I put my phone. I'm always catching. This is just really nice in that way. So that design choice is very good. I just don't like the style because it makes you look like you're in like one of those movies where they put a collar around your neck that explodes if you don't do what the bad guy says. That's why I don't like it. That's the only reason. It has nothing to do with Phaeton or Phiaton or Phiaton or whatever they are. It has nothing to do with any of that or whoever came up with this design. I just don't much like the way it looks because I think my head's going to explode.
And now, I'm guessing for climbing, since you do a lot of climbing, that it might not be the best design for that, since at some point you might be kind of upside down or hanging with your head back.
Yeah, it's... Yeah, well, it's definitely going to want to come off. Yeah. And I still have problems with in-ear monitors coming out. So these are very comfortable. I cannot complain about the comfort level of these at all. I still can't really get them to stay in, you know, permanently. But that's just them. Now, Austin, while I'm talking, figure out how much these things cost, because I meant to look it up and I forgot. BT100NC, Phaeton. Anyway, so... What really matters, of course, are the two things, noise canceling and how they sound. I usually just use headphones when I'm mowing the grass. It blocks out enough of the noise that I feel like I'm getting some earring protection, plus I get to listen to music. And I was using these to mow the grass, and I forgot that they had noise canceling. So I had mowed most of the grass, and I was like, oh, yeah, they have noise canceling. So I flicked them on. I was like, oh, my God, that is so good. I mean, it really, really worked. Now, in a low... noise area. If you turn it on, like in this room right now, you will hear a hiss. There's a hiss.
All right. We'll hear that's very common with the noise canceling.
That is very common. So, but if you're on the airplane, you're not going to hear the hiss no matter what. And it really works pretty well. And it doesn't have quite their solution. Seems whatever this doesn't have quite that same, like your ears are plugged sort of sound. To it. You know, a lot of times it feels like your ears are plugged when you turn on noise canceling. This ones don't feel quite as bad, at least in my experience that I've used with them. So it's really worked well as the noise canceling part of it. I was using it just like before here. Like I had a fan on high because I was trying to cool this room off before I got in here. And I was like, oh, just turn it on. Oh, yeah, that really works. I turn it back off. On. I'm like, oh, look at that. This really works. It's really quite effective.
How long does the battery last?
I haven't killed it yet, and I've tried. So, in fact, I'm using them for the podcast right now. They're connected to my computer while the mic and stuff is going through other things, and I'm like, okay, well, it dies during the podcast, and we'll know. But I charged them a couple of days ago. I haven't really used them much in those couple of days, but I have used them a bit, and they've been sitting around, so if the battery dies as it slowly sits around. But, you know, I would expect the battery's going to die. It's going to be like a six to eight-hour battery. Yeah, you know, that's usually what these things are. And for me, for most people, I think it's, you know, battery longevity is not a humongous issue. But I have a hard time testing these things to battery death because a lot of times they have some sort of little power function or if they're not being used, they shut themselves down. So and I can't sit there with music going in my ears for 8 hours a day. I just can't. I don't have the time for that. So I guess you can... look to other reviewers for that. But sonically, was very impressed. Listened to a couple of bass sweeps. Very good low extension. At the high end, as the high end goes up, you know, and with almost every single one of these headphones, right when it gets towards that high end, you hear that little dip. Mm-hmm. You know, there's always that little weird dip up there with a lot of headphones. Of course, stuff like the Oppos aren't going to be quite as bad. But they seem to be pretty well extended. Sonically, they're very easy to listen to. They don't sound overblown in the bass area.
All right.
From my listening, they sound pretty even. Might have a little bit of a hump. I'm not going to say don't have a little bit of a boost, but considering that everybody wants a bass boost these days, you're almost kind of stuck with that. But what really got me was I was listening to the doctor, whatever his name is, Ultimate
Chesky?
Surround. Yeah, Chesky's Ultimate Surround Disc or whatever it is, the binaural recordings. And these do a pretty good job of getting that voice in front of you.
Oh,
now,
all right.
For me, it's like if the person was like their mouth was about 3 inches in front of my face and right about in line with my forehead. That's where the in front of me was, but it was in front of me. And it seemed to have more depth to the back, and I guess that's going to be the case with most headphones, but like the front left and right surround voices were really, really good. The fronts sounded a little bit closer to you than the backs, but they were really good. And the shaker test is the one that I can usually hear the best, and that one went right straight in front of my eyes, you know, at a distance pretty well. So imaging with these things was what that basically comes down to. Imaging is very, very good, and it's outside your head too. There is nice. Some inside stuff, but it's definitely gets it outside your head. So sonically, I'm really super impressed. How much do these cost, Austin?
$120.
Ah, look at that.
Not
That's
bad
a good
at
price.
All.
Yes. So thumbs up. If you're looking for noise canceling and you like this blow your head off design, Tom gives it thumbs up. I really like them. I'm very impressed.
There
all right,
you go.
What else were we supposed to talk about? I don't remember.
Listeners of the week.
Yes, that's we have listeners of the week. So, all right. So, I know. Did you guys mention James last week? That he's helping me out with the whole.
We mentioned that he's helping you out, but we didn't know the end of the story. So
we still don't know the end of the story. It hasn't arrived yet. But when it arrives, James, you will be a listener of the week. But other listeners of the week. In fact, I got another donation today too from somebody. I'm not sure who that was. So we'll.
Oh yes, I saw an email in there, but it came today, yeah. So it didn't make it on the topic list.
Doesn't make it on the topic list. So this week we have a couple people that gave us some donations. So to give us a donation, you go to www.avrant.com and you click on the Buy Us a Cup of Coffee link, which will take you to a PayPal donation, which you can, if you have a PayPal account, you just transfer money. If you have a credit card, you put it in there, and PayPal keeps you safe and all that stuff, and we never see your credit card number. You can write a little note to us if you want us to mention something specific or tell us why, which is always nice. but we have Lior. Alan, are we going with Toby on that one?
I think so. That's how he always signs off his emails, so I'm going to assume that's what he wants to be called.
Okay, so Toby and Diego all left us PayPal donations this week, which is fantastic.
Thank you, gentlemen. Very much needed.
So, while I have no specific news yet on my wife, those of you that have been interested in that, because you know that when my financial situation gets better, then I'm going to that my life gets better, and therefore I have more time to devote to this podcast. We think my wife will be employed next week. We think that's probably going to happen, so I'm excited about that.
That's exciting.
Yes, it is.
Yes. See, Dawson was already a help. Look at that. You see, we need him around. Verge or keep, Austin. All the big bucks you've been making on this podcast.
Yeah, that's right. What a position we've given you.
I swear I'm gonna get that
Patreon.
Yes. It's been bugging me, and I just haven't got. Last week was crazy.
Yeah.
People coming from Australia that I used to know there came in their new little baby, and they came over for dinner at the last minute. I haven't eaten at home in like 5 straight nights. You know, I've just been out everywhere. And camping was great, but being trapped with your children for 3 straight days, yeah.
Didn't they have space to run around? Isn't that the idea?
You think they would run around if they stayed really close. I did not approve of that. This week in the news, I have a friend who has got a Kickstarter campaign. It's called The Grave. The Grave is a short film that they're trying to shoot. It is the same group that did the Post-Human Project, if you've ever heard of that. That is a movie. I think it took them 3 years to make that movie. So if you give them the name for this movie, it ain't coming out next week, I don't think. So just
was the
Post-Human
Project like feature length, or was that a short one as well?
Christina, I thought it went to Cannes or something, so I think it was feature length.
Hmm.
So it actually went to some film festivals, so I'm not sure if what it was, but this one is a short film, and it's really kind of cool. It's set in 1920s Oklahoma City, and it's the guy is sort of a vigilante sort of thing, and it's very noir-esque, and it looks like a lot of fun. It's got 12 days to go as of today, November 30th, and it's nowhere near its goal. So yeah. if you guys would like to help support that project, I think it would be pretty cool. The guy who is one of the writers is Matthew Price, and I think he's producer too, and he's a fan of the Bob Moore books, so that's how I know this guy.
Cool.
And so
when is the next Bob book coming?
Yeah,
ever coming out.
It exists. I have gone through and tried to edit that book into completion. I've gotten up through chapter, like it's got 24 chapters, I think. I've gotten through like chapter 10, like three different occasions, and then life gets in the way, and I haven't been able to finish it. So it is my fault. I will do it. It is there. You know, I should start a Kickstarter campaign. Give me like $5,000, and I'll take a month off and just do nothing but Bob Moore and this podcast. I should do that, but I don't see.
That would be sweet.
Yep.
That would be sweet. Rob, you've got some news. It looks like Dolby Atmos is being adopted for clubs so that DJs can use it live.
Yeah.
Is this a thing?
This is a thing, yeah. So apparently these were like, this seems like it was a bit of a skunk's work project by a couple of guys over at Dolby who were like, they basically developed this thing on their own time, like after work, they just hung around. But they have a thing now they're calling the Dolby Panner, which you can use live. So whatever you're mixing through it, you can pan it live three-dimensionally as long as you have installed overhead speakers and you have the Dolby Panner and the separate processing box, of course, because it has to be able to process object-based audio to make use of these overhead speakers. So the whole thing is like officially part of Dolby. It'll be a licensed thing. So if you're a live DJ and you want to use it, you will have to pay a license and buy the equipment because it's all official Dolby stuff. But it's kind of cool because they're like, hey, look, in a movie, we know that, look, the screen's in front of you. The majority of the sound's going to come from in front of you. And then only sounds where it makes sense for it to be going overhead or around you. That's what we're going to mix. But in a club or in a music setting, it's like, there's not really any reason why you couldn't put whatever sound wherever you want to. So it makes it a little bit scary of what some people might get overly zealous about using the effects, but it's cool that it just can be done live, which will also definitely have applications in video games too, because, you know, live mixing of object-based audio is going to be useful. So plenty of application for this.
Yeah, you know, I like this idea. I like it a lot. And I see this not so much for DJs, but maybe for stadiums.
Yeah.
You know, when they're having these Taylor Swift $150 pop ticket concert. Friend of mine's mom went to it. I'm like, why is your mom going to a Taylor Swift concert? He's like, I don't know. But anyway, and then when you went in, they scanned you your ticket to see where you sat. They gave you a special bracelet, and they scanned the bracelet. Mm-hmm. And the bracelet was like LED lights and stuff, and the entire thing would glow and change colors.
So during
the concert, your bracelet was part of the lighting scheme. So if you're going to have something like that, they're definitely going to do stuff like this where the voices come or whatever comes from all over. You could really freak some kids out at a club, though. Man, I got some bad eggs or something. The voice is coming from everywhere. What's going on? I'm going home.
Yeah, it's going to be fun, though. I'm looking forward to it. Not that I go to clubs, but it's going to be fun.
Yeah, I was going to say. This is how the story goes, and Austin, back me up. This is the story. Rob has never been to a club before. He hears there's a club like this, goes, and then the next day he comes home. The next time he comes to the podcast, he's like, it was really cool. I guess I'm going to have to go to it again, but I really – ugh. You know that, or he comes home, he's like, I woke up in some strange girl's house. Which could also be awesome. That would be a good story.
Yeah,
all right,
one way to get me into a club, it's Atmos.
Raspberry Pi Zero is a $5 computer, which can play what? Like,
it can take the version of Linux that runs on Raspberry Pi. It'll run that just fine. So there's your operating system. If it can do that, it should be able to run Kodi if you want to use it as a home theater PC. It should be able to run basic programs that the other Raspberry Pis can. I mean, they're saying it's actually more powerful than the very first Raspberry Pi that ever came out.
I believe that. How big is it? Like the size of your thumb?
It's tiny. It's smaller than a credit card. I mean, it's not as thin as a credit card. Obviously, there has to be some tiny... I mean, it's so small that the output ports are like an HDMI micro jack and a USB micro jack. So to connect anything to it, you have to have like breakout cables, which are not included in the $5 price.
of course, they're not.
That ups it a little bit.
But... make sure you get the good cables, though, because that makes the electrons happier as they go through it.
Yeah, we talked about that last week.
All right,
$5 computer. I mean,
if I was a little bit more, if I had more time, and was more adventurous. Yeah. I think I would be really into stuff like that.
Yeah. But no, they're you know, the Raspberry Pi guys were like, we want to remove all barriers to entry for anyone who wants to play around with programming a computer. And it's like, they have to charge something, but $5 is about as cheap as they can get it. I'm like, yeah, that's reasonably cheap, guys. That's a pretty good job.
That's vending machine cheap. Are you kidding me? That's vending. That's vending machine cheap.
I don't know how they're going to ship it to you for, you know, that's going to cost more money. I mean, the thing's so small.
An envelope.
Yeah, they're talking about an envelope. That's right.
It's just being a padded envelope.
Put a stamp
Exactly.
That's right.
Pretty much.
Send it by carrier pigeon. All right. So we have some comments. Carl shared the featurette on the 65mm Ultra Panasonic filming and 70mm Panavision. Sorry, and 70mm Roadshow release of Quentin Tarantino's The Hateful Eight, which I watched a part of that. I think the things that are going to be most interesting there is the fact that they're encouraging you to go to the theater because the Roadshow release will have more content.
Yes, because Quentin Tarantino films, if there's one knock against them, it's that they're always too short.
Yeah. There's not enough filming from the back of the head. There needs to be more of that.
So I'm not sure that some 15 extra minutes of footage is really what was needed, but
that is intermission and overshoot.
Intermission.
Stuff, though,
so. Yeah, that's right.
Are they really going to have an intermission?
They're gonna,
yeah,
if
they're
it's
doing
Quentin
the full
Tarantino.
Old-fashioned roadshow release thing.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure they'll like create a newsreel just to have a newsreel in front of it.
Will.
I'm certain of it. It's Quentin Tarantino. You know he'll do that.
Well, that whole thing with what was the movie with the zombies and stuff that he did with Robert Rodriguez, and they did those two sort of art house type films. You know, the slasher.
Yeah, he did the
Grindhouse.
Yeah, Grindhouse. That's what I meant. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, he did the whole. Well, look at the film got messed up and the sex scene is all, yeah. That irritated me. It also irritated me when the film quality goes bad just because it's a directorial choice. It's like, listen, don't do that. I have HDTV and I have a very big screen and I get to see every grain very large. Stop it.
Now, I found it interesting that they called it Ultra Panavision because I remember that format being called Cinerama, where they actually had 3 4x3 aspect ratio projectors. Side by side.
Well, original Cinerama was that before the way that and Cinerama is now the same thing. That's the 70mm projection side of the Ultra Panavision, which is the production side, and they just use really, really wide anamorphic lenses.
Yeah, which sides. What did they say? They found like 5 of them, but they were all different, so they had to like literally modify modern cameras so they could attach these like old lenses onto them. And I'm like, that's, you know, why not?
Haven't been
it's
used
fun.
Since like 1965.
That's right.
So.
Like sitting in storage, but they're glass. They should be okay.
Yeah, they're okay. I will say the one thing about it is that they made such a big deal. Everybody's like, we're really in a movie now because we're shooting on film. I'm like, it doesn't matter. You could have adapted these same. If you want to use the older Panavision lenses, fine. That's cool. But use the Arri Alexa 65. Shoot it on digital. You don't have to do it on 65mm film.
It's Quentin Tarantino.
I know it is.
Well, it's not. You know, it's not just that because you hear that sort of stuff all the time, and the validity of what they're saying is undeniably wrong. You know, it's like, oh, we're doing this on 70mm and we're filming it on real films, therefore it makes it different. No. You feel like you're doing it differently because you're shooting on this film. Therefore, it is different because of your emotions during this time, how you're feeling. But it has nothing to do with the actual medium itself. You could do this digitally and come up with the exact same result, but you wouldn't because you feel like you were doing something differently. So that's the way I look at it. I'm like, fine. You know what? Whatever, you know, Cinema School, BS you want to spew in order to make yourself feel like you're creating a real masterpiece, fine. Just create the masterpiece so that I can watch it. That's all I really want out of this.
Yeah, good luck bringing this home. I don't know how they're going to do it, but...
Whatever. All right, Andrew on Facebook sent the video, visualizing standing waves using actual fire. Was this set to music? I think I've seen this one before. I forgot to click on it
It was music creating the fire.
Yeah. Okay, I've seen that before. There's pianos and stuff all over the place. Yeah, that's pretty cool. We'll send that link up there. It's a
Rubens tube. That's what it is. It's a Rubens tube.
So, and John on Facebook wanted to correct Rob, regarding being able to use the Dolby Surround up mixer with DTS bit streams. He said that it's only Den and Marantz that no longer let you use the DSU with DTS bit streams.
Yeah, he's got a Denon. It's the 3050. I poured through the manual, and yeah, there's nothing in the manual that says you can't use the Dolby Surround Up mixer with DTS bit streams the way it does in Denon and Marantz's current models. And once again, I want to clarify the models that came out last year in 2014, the ones that could not be upgraded to DTS:X in any way, those ones let you use the Dolby Surround Up mixer with DTS bit streams and anything else. So yeah. He's correct. Certainly for Yamaha, I didn't pour through all the Onkyo ones. He was correct that the current Pioneer ones, the something 9 series, the ones that all have a 9 at the front of the model number, those ones say they're going to have DTS:X upgrades coming, and they don't mention not being able to use Dolby Surround Up Mixer. So he's right. It's Denon and Marantz. We were talking specifically about a Denon model last week, so I'm not incorrect about that part of it. But he's like, don't blame DTS. This was a decision on Denon and Marantz's part, and it appears to be so. So,
yeah.
Good correction.
All right,
thank you.
So you guys managed to leave 2 questions left over from last week.
We sure did.
So we will try to go through those real quick here. Let me find out where I left this thing. All right. So James forwarded us a video from last year's Rocky Mountain Audio Festival, which is a source of great information and hilarity. Hosted by a rep from AudioQuest called Computer Audio Demystified.
Which is an ironic title. I would rather call it Computer Audio Mystified.
Okay, the first 4.5 minutes of this video is kind of him setting up and saying that his 2-year-old kid's in there, so nobody curse, basically, is what it sounded like he was saying. I don't know, he said be nice. So I thought maybe he was afraid somebody was going to throw a shoe at him or something, which certainly could have happened if I was there. But, so then he gets into this how to make your audio coming out of your computer sound better. And he starts off with this statement that he says completely deadpan, without a trace of irony, that quad cores sound better than dual cores.
That's right.
Just straight up processors, quad cores kind of sound better than dual cores.
Across
and
the board.
There's no question, he says.
There's no question.
No,
yeah.
There's no question.
No question.
You know, quad core ARM processor versus a dual core Xeon processor. Yep, quad core is going to sound better.
Every time. It's 4. You can see that there's 4, right? Not 2. See the 4, 2. 4 better, 2 worse. I don't even have to really listen to know that. And then he goes on with, you need the best computer that you can get, so you need to have high, you know, good RAM, at least 8 gigs.
For 2-channel audio.
For 2-channel.
Lots of RAM.
Yeah, you need 2, at least 8, a minimum of 8 is what he's found, but 16 would be better because you want the headroom.
For 2-channel audio.
For 2-channel audio.
That's lossless.
You know, the funny thing is, he never once mentions DAX or any sort of outputs. You just like, nope. Just computer stuff. So
SSDs
the thing
sound
is,
better than mechanical hard drives.
Yeah.
Oh, I went on about that. Yeah.
Oh yes.
Unequivocally.
Yes. Oh, and laptops are better than Mac minis because laptops are held to a higher standard because they have to be quieter. Or whatever.
They have to emit less radiation. That's what
he said.
Less radiation.
Like, wait a second.
Coming out
is that
the
because
optical
I'm putting
it
on my lap and it's near my junk and that's why it can't have radiation? Like, all the rest of them, what are the rest of them? Turning us all into the Hulk? I listened to the part where he started talking about cables and I had to switch off because I had other things to do. But Listen to what he says if you would like to build yourself a decent computer. Just realize that every excuse, every reason that he gives you for doing these things is completely and utterly ludicrously false. Like, there's just nothing that he says about, nothing that you're going to do is going to make your audio sound better. That's the message that you need to take away from that. But you will have a damn nice computer by the end of it. That's
so
sure.
Far gone. I wrote a comment on the YouTube video where I was like, this is a parody, right? Like, this is someone, this is like Stephen Colbert's version of audio, like making fun of,
straight up.
But it's not. It is totally not. And I am so disappointed because this guy says he was, I don't know exactly how he was involved in developing the Dragonfly, which is a little USB external DAC that you can plug into the USB port of your computer to take audio out of it that way, which is a reasonably priced and good device. Like, it's a good little USB DAC, and it's not exorbitantly priced. I feel horrible about ever recommending that product ever again because this guy was involved in it. That's how bad this video is.
And because you'd have to recommend AudioQuest at the same time.
That is true.
This is it's brutal. There is so much misinformation here. And I mean, the thing is, like, yes, taking iTunes out of its default import settings where it'll turn your CDs into 128 kilobit AAC.
Go ahead, do that.
That's fine. He got one thing right. That's fine. You know, there is always some nugget of truth mixed in amongst all the bull that you will find in these types of seminars. But it's just unbelievable that, I mean, I saw two people on the video walk out that they did not come back in, so that was not a bathroom break. But I was like, how did everybody not just get up and leave? Like, on the
because
first sentence.
At Rocky Mountain Audio Fest.
That's exactly right. They all, he is preaching to the choir. Absolutely.
And external hard drive is always better than an internal hard drive, but Thunderbolt is better than USB, and network is better than Thunderbolt. Like, because I guess it moves farther away from the PC. I don't, what? No, how does any of this make any, we talked about digital signals last week, Lee and myself. I don't know if we offended anybody or hurt anybody's feelings with that. That's not our intent. We were trying to be as objective as we could be, but this takes it to a whole other level. And I mean, last week it was talking about AudioQuest cables. Now we're talking about a rep from AudioQuest trying to quote unquote demystify computer audio while spouting off so much misinformation that you would be led completely astray if you listen to what this guy says.
You would still have a good computer, and it would sound good, but not from
any
other
reasons. Imported your CDs. You would have imported your CDs in lossless rather than lossy. Yeah. Okay, yeah.
The thing that got me is that it's like there were so many speed bumps in this talk.
Oh, yeah.
Like, as you listened, he would be saying stuff. I'd be like, yeah, I agree with that. Yeah, I agree with that. And it'll make your audio sound better. I'm like, what? What? No. What? When we talk, oh, okay, yes, build a computer, do this, yes, oh, yes, that's a good idea, yes, solid state, I like solid state, too, it also sounds better. What? Boom, yeah, and I fall again.
He had the little audio clips that he played, the same song that he played repeatedly. There was, you know, huge spans of several minutes in between each time he played it, so good luck remembering what it sounded like last time. And he's always like, oh, did you hear a difference? You know, because we upgraded from a standard USB generic cable to a $300 AudioQuest USB cable. But it would have been even better if it had been a generic Thunderbolt, according to everything he said. Would have been better if it had been generic Ethernet, although they have a $500 Ethernet cable too. And that would have been the best of all. But, like, putting all that aside, I love the example where he reaches over and turns up the volume dial on the external DAC that he was using, and then said, did you hear a difference? Yeah, I did. It was louder. Surprise. Mm-hmm. He reached over to the front and turned it up.
It really doesn't matter. Those people are not listening to this podcast. You do know that, right? They're just not. That's fine. You know what? Unlike Rob, like, I don't care. Like, I don't care how crazy Picasso was. I like his paintings. Right? And I don't care how nutty this guy is. The device he made works and does what it proclaims to do and isn't overly expensive.
Seemingly by mistake. By happenstance, it works.
Dude, you give a blind man enough darts, he's going to get a bullseye eventually.
How is
Who cares that he was blind?
It's not exorbitantly expensive. That's a miracle.
I know. That's the real miracle. They haven't figured out how they charge them. But that's what, I just don't think that they value those things. Anyway. All right, so Richard over on Twitter says he has to get a new TV. It's 55 inches is the limit. Yep. Does that include the case or just the size of the screen?
Obviously some do have different bezel sizes, but 55 inches is the diagonal screen size he's looking for.
All right. And he'd like to be ready for HDR if he's going to buy a new TV. He was considering the Sony, blah, 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 X850C series.
Yeah.
Any thoughts? And Rob came up with a, I don't know, is this Rob that you came up with this article here?
Yeah, because it's, pertinent to what he was saying. Yeah, because HD Guru did a nice summary where they basically looked at pretty much all the Ultra HD TVs that are out there. Now, not all of the Ultra HD TVs have high dynamic range capability. In fact, very few of them presently do. But they are broken down by what each of them can do and then gives model numbers and stuff like that. If you want to be ready for HDR, it's essentially impossible because we don't really know how this is going to play out. It looks as though we're going to have a dual format standard, possibly three if BBC's over in Europe is separate because they have their own. HLG, I think they're calling it, something hybrid, something gamma. Whole idea being it doesn't even need to have metadata attached to it because it just has like extra gamma that only their decoder will understand. So interesting, but it looks like, just how on our AV receivers we have Dolby Digital and DTS, right? We had Dolby True HD and DTS HD Master Audio. Now we're going to have Dolby Atmos and we're going to have DTS X. So on our TVs, it's looking more and more likely that we're just going to have HDR10 and Dolby Vision and that they will sort of live side by side. But presently, there isn't a single TV that you can buy right this second that handles both. The most likely candidate, because it is upgradable through their evolution kits, which is a separate hardware that you can attach to the back of the thing, is Samsung's SU-HD.
Yeah, but they don't have a 55-inch on this list here that I'm looking at.
Well, not in the JS9500 series, which is the best. That's the one with full array local dimming and the wider color gamut. But in their edge-lit SUHD models, they have some 55 inches, and those can still use the evolution kit. So it's very tough to recommend getting an HDR. Like, if I were to buy an HDR TV myself, I would only look at the JS9500 series, the smallest of which is 65 inches, because that's the only one I think even might support both formats. The rest, I really don't think they will.
What about the LGs? There's a 55 inch LG up here,
which is an OLED. Yeah, it's an OLED. It's the flat OLED.
Yeah.
It does support HDR10. We don't know if it can be upgraded to support Dolby Vision or not. Like, we don't know how that's going to work yet. But it is HDR10 compatible. Now the X850C series that he was looking at, over at the Wirecutter, and I know David Katzenmeyer has been comparing it too. They've basically been saying, look, the LG looks the best, the OLED.
Mm-hmm.
The Samsung is like the safest way to go, the JS9500. The Vizio Reference Series is the only way to get Dolby Vision right now, but it doesn't do HDR10. And it's like, and then behind all of that, there's the Sony, which actually right this moment can't even connect to an external HDR source. It's only its built-in apps that can do HDR. And out of all of those apps, only Amazon right this moment. So it is a mess when it comes to high dynamic range if you're trying to buy something right now. So it's really, if there was an answer I could give you, Richard, I would give it to you because I'm looking for it too. I would love to be able to, but this is very similar to when we were trying to recommend AV receivers in 2014 last year. We were like, if you can wait 1 year, because I guarantee you in 6 to 8 months when there CES is coming up in January, it's going to be filled with HDR announcements. I guarantee it.
Yeah.
And then those models are going to start coming out in probably May through the summer, right? When they normally do. If you can wait that long, that's going to be the time to strike, just like how now is a pretty good time to buy an AV receiver because they support all the things we want them to support. So it's tough. If you have to buy a TV right this second, I would say get the cheapest one that satisfies your needs so that you won't feel so bad upgrading again in maybe 2 years or something like that.
Yeah, because the LG is double what the...
Those OLEDs are still expensive. They're way cheaper than they used to be. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, they're way cheaper than they used to
be. But $3,000 for a 55-inch, that's not an insignificant
expenditure. But that's when my parents bought their plasma, I think they got a 55 or something like that, and it was like 2400.
But you know, none of them other than Samsung support Vidity. Vidity is only on Samsung right now. We're hoping everybody will be able to upgrade this stuff via firmware, but we really don't know. It's possible they won't be able to.
All right, Timothy heard me say on a recent podcast that most mass market entry-level speakers tend to have dramatically rolled-off highs. I remember saying that, but that doesn't sound untrue. As he has a Polk Monitor Series 2s for his front three speakers and uses Odyssey reference setting, does that mean that his high frequencies are being rolled off twice? Should he EQ to compensate, or is he overthinking this? You're overthinking it. Basically, Odyssey, think of it this way. Odyssey is analyzing your response and trying to match it to what it is, a flat frequency response, and it slightly rolls off the highs.
Yeah, at the reference setting. Yeah.
With the reference setting. So if you've already got rolled off highs, it's not going to roll them off again. It's not like it's not a set in stone. Oh yes, and take all the highs down 3 dB. No, it looks to see what's there and then tries to make it match. Yeah. So I wouldn't worry about that.
Yeah, it measures what your speakers do natively, and then it compares that to a target curve. And then it says, how far away is what the speakers do natively from the target that I'm trying to hit? And if they're rolled off more than the roll-off that's in the target, it's going to boost up those high frequencies a little bit. If the natural roll-off of the speakers actually already matches the target roll-off in that reference curve, it's not going to touch them. It's going to say, hey, you already matched the target. Or if it doesn't roll off enough, it's going to roll them off a little bit. So that's what it's equalizing to match a target
and
curve.
And if they're rolled off too much, then it's going to try to boost them a little bit.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah, so, yeah. So don't worry about it if you have it can only do so much.
I mean, there are some... there are some speakers out there that are rolled off so much that no matter how much it boosts it, it's never going to reach its target curve because
it can't make a driver play a sound that it can't play.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. It just can't do it. So. Yeah. What speakers do you have again, Austin?
What are they? They're Phase.
Phase Tech.
Phase Techs. Yeah.
Oh, FaceTech.
That's right.
Okay.
I forgot you were living up in Jacksonville, which is where FaceTech is from. You can just go there, and say, I want that one.
I actually had them before that. I had them when I was in Texas and took them to Florida and then brought them back. So,
yeah, there was a higher-end show in Jacksonville I went to one time where it was a bunch of just nonsense. I remember talking about it on the podcast. But FaceTech was there, and they were like, yeah, it's in town. So they make some pretty decent speakers. So
I mean, FaceTech was the first ones to do that crazy Odyssey-based system, where it was an individual amplifier for every single driver in the speaker, not just an amplifier per speaker, an amplifier per driver with Odyssey correction for each individual driver and active crossovers between all the drivers with that whole system. As far as I know, they're still the only ones who have that. So
that system right there, everybody who I know who has heard it just loves it. Says it's the best thing they've ever heard. It's supposed to be amazing. Anyways, okay, Antoine. Right, anyways, wanted a quick reminder of some websites where you can buy acoustic panels, preferably at low prices. Mm-hmm. This is, of course, Geek. This is the one we normally recommend. This is a little reminder. Geek kind of got started on the forums of Audioholics, believe it or not.
Yeah.
He was doing it out of his garage and sent us some panels, and we sort of talked him up, and he exploded. Mostly because of his prices, and he does good work. So, he sells stuff raw. So if you want to build it yourself, you can buy the raw materials from him if you can't find a place to buy it locally.
Yeah, and in my opinion, they have the most complete portfolio of acoustic panel products because it's not just absorbers, which lots of places sell, but also diffusers and then scatter plates that can go on top of absorbers so that you have absorption and diffusion at the same time, and then the new tuned membranes that can go on top of absorption or just individual tuned bass traps for very specific frequencies. If you have like one huge standing wave and you're not going to add a second or four subwoofers to fix it. You can get one of their Scopus tune bass traps. So, you know, sealing things and stuff like that. So a very complete portfolio over at Gick. And none of it overpriced. Yeah.
They have stands for their stuff if you if you have a panel that you want to be able to place, but you won't leave it there forever. So you can move things around. So they're very good. There's Acoustimac and ATSA Acoustics or ATS Acoustics, right? Is that what the other one?
Yeah, ATS Acoustics. I'll mention ATS. They have backer boards on the back of all of their panels, which I'm not a huge fan of because you know, it makes them a lot less effective. You actually want an air gap, preferably, between the back of the panel and the wall, which helps it be that much more effective because it's that many more transitions between mediums, which is another thing we talked about last week. Sound waves do not like to transition between mediums. They lose energy every time they do, so it helps to have the absorption and then an air gap and then the wall and then back through the air gap and then back through the panel. It makes it more efficient. So I'm not a huge fan of putting a backer board back there, but ATS does. Good place to get the raw materials, though.
If you ever want to test that next time you're in the pool, just like sink your ears under the water and then talk, you know, your face is right there, and your mouth is real close, and just transferring into the water makes a big difference. Infinite Gary, he read an article by Anthony Grimani that says home theaters require a minimum of 4 subs, and movies demand a peak output of 115 dB.
Okay.
Demand.
Okay.
Well, I mean, that is full reference volume.
I know.
In the LFE channel only, the low frequency effects channel only, does peak out at 115 dB. That's correct.
Yeah. I mean, that's what it should have. Yeah. Anyways, I don't know about the 4 subs thing. Well, this seems like to him like it would be way too loud. If he lost his mind and wanted to experience 115 dB, would it even be possible given his room size and equipment? He's got a 11.5 by 26 foot room. He's got a couple of Dynaudio sub 600s and 4 acoustic elegance. Oh, he's got his infinite baffle subwoofer. So,
I mean,
just turn them very, very loud if you really want to.
It will be very
just
loud.
Keep going until it stops. The thing catches on fire. You can certainly get 100. I bet you get 115 when you're watching a movie that's really loud and there's an explosion. I bet you're getting pretty close to 115 if you're having the dialogue be, you know, movie experience. Mm-hmm. If you've got the dialogue and those quieter moments in the movie at movie level experience, if you're not turning it up and down between scenes, those loudest sounds are probably getting pretty dang close to 115 dB, dude. You're probably
several things going on, because first of all, the 115 dB, like I said, it's only in the LFE channel. It's not in any of the speaker channels. The speaker channels peak out at 105 dB, so strictly for the LFE channel, and it is peaks. It's momentary peaks. This is not average. This is not sustained. It is short, momentary peaks that can go as high as 115 dB in that LFE channel. Inside a room, right, like some people look at the measurements of subwoofers, right? Let's take the SVS PB13 Ultra as an example, because Audioholics, Josh Ritchie, did the full measurements and everything like that. Now, out in a wide open field, right, there's only the ground. There are no walls or ceiling. Just a wide open field, that thing can play right down to 20 hertz at 110 dB from 2 meters away. Sustained, it can play 110 dB, right? Now, you put that inside a room and you instantly gain about 6 dB just from there being walls and a ceiling. Didn't change anything else. So already that's hitting 115 dB in anything that you would call a reasonably sized room. That's a single 13-inch driver with a 1,000-watt amplifier. He has 4 15-inch drivers with 2,000 watts of amplification powering them. Yes, you can hit this, Gary. You can absolutely hit this. There's no question about that. But yeah, you would have to lose your mind to sustain it at that level, because you could definitely hurt your hearing.
You could hurt your ears, definitely. Yeah, but I'm telling you, Gary, I think you're probably already there.
Yeah.
More than likely, if you're watching Lord of the Rings or The Dark Knight or something like that, and you've got it up loud, I mean, not hurting your ears loud the entire time, but nice and movie theater loud, those subs are probably hitting 115 or dang close to it, dude.
Yeah.
So you have experienced it. Yeah.
Short little moments.
If you've felt the bass, chances are you probably are hitting 115. That's what I think. Anyways, Gary's Theater was built on an analysis by Chris Hudson. The design included 45-degree angled panels on the ceiling over the center of the room, 6 feet from the front wall to 6 feet from the back wall, so they cover about 14 feet over the central part of the room. Exactly what effect are these panels having on the sound of the room? Well, I think the idea was diffusion. That's what it kind of looks like.
Yep.
To have them all in the same direction isn't the most effective diffusion, really, because diffusion usually should be pointed in all different directions so things go in all sorts of different ways.
Yeah, I mean, what they're attempting to do here, because first of all, let's focus on what frequencies these things are affecting, because these are square panels that are embedded in the ceiling. He has acoustically transparent fabric covering his ceiling, so the sound waves are going right.
To remind people, we've talked about this many, many, I think probably years ago at this point. Mm-hmm. His ceiling, his top of his ceiling, like where you would have drywall, it's all open. So you can basically see all the rafters of the boards, right? So what they did is they put stuff in there, like these 45-degree boards and maybe some, I don't know what else they might have put up there. And then they put acoustically transparent fabric over the top so that it doesn't look like a disgusting room that has the rafters open. So it's a really, really elegant solution. To be honest with you, I think that's a really interesting way to go, especially if you're not worried about upstairs neighbors or upstairs people or in upstairs. that you could just put some insulation on another level above that, and it gives you this really easy way to run some speakers or put some acoustical panels up there or this weird diffusion thing that he's got going on.
But basically the size of these pieces of wood that are at 45 degrees angles in his ceiling, it looks like 16-inch on center joists. It looks like they're square pieces of wood, so that means they're probably, 15 and a quarter inches square? That's probably the size of them, somewhere around that. Let's call it 16 inches square just to be easier. Basically, once you get waves, sound waves, that are longer than that size, the sound wave itself exceeds that size of that square, it starts to wrap around that square rather than being reflected off of that square, particularly once that square becomes only a quarter of the wavelength. So roughly 250 hertz or so, those pieces of wood are having no effect. The sound waves are completely wrapping around it as if they weren't there. It's going around them like teeny tiny little pebbles in a stream, barely obstructing the flow of the sound wave at all. And all the way up to about 850, 900 hertz or so, it's having relatively little effect. So this is definitely working mostly on your, let's call it 1,000 hertz and up. That's where it's really having an impact. Mm-hmm. Now, when sound waves that are shorter than the thing that they're hitting hits an object like that, the angle of incidence is equal to the angle of reflection, just like shooting a pool ball off of the bank of a pool table. But of course, now what you've done is you've turned the angle rather than it being a flat ceiling so that you can just say, hey, the sound went up and it bounces back down, same angle on to off. Now it's going up and hitting an angled part of the ceiling. And as you move farther and farther back in the room away from the front speakers, that angle is changing because all of the slats are at 45 degrees, but the distance and the angle of incidence is changing as it goes back. But it is reflecting all of these sound waves above about 900 hertz or so evenly, the same way a flat would, but every sound wave that's hitting any given panel in the ceiling is reflecting the same. It's not truly scattering the high frequencies. It's just changing the angles of reflection throughout the room.
It does look like above that he's got insulation.
That could be, yeah.
So what I'm thinking is that those lower frequencies that are wrapping around these pieces of wood are going to just go into that insulation and come back out and do whatever they do.
Effectively, the difference between what Gary would be hearing in his room with this ceiling setup versus just a traditional flat drywall ceiling is normally you do have strong first reflections off of the ceiling, just as you do off of your side walls. Those are being directed at an angle that is unusual and are essentially not reaching his ears. He still has first reflections. He's going to have first reflections that coincide with the sound wave came out of the speaker, traveled up to the ceiling, hit a 45-degree angled piece of wood somewhere in that ceiling that was at the correct angle to send that reflection back down to his ears. Because there is somewhere, right. somewhere in that room that that situation exists. So what he's essentially done is moved his first reflection, but not eliminated it, and not actually scattered all of those sounds. A normal diffuser has many different surfaces on it, so that different frequencies are reflected in different directions, because, again, it depends on the size of the thing it's hitting, which sound waves will wrap around it and which will reflect off of it. So you have these oddly jagged-shaped things that are usually diffusers, not just uniform pieces of wood that
and they're mathematically usually they use some sort of mathematical algorithm to calculate the different sizes to make them as diffuse as possible.
So it's interesting. It is. I mean, you've essentially moved your first reflection, Gary. That's what you've done. You've moved it to a spot where we wouldn't normally expect it to be coming off of a flat ceiling.
Yeah, so to figure out where that new first reflection is, you need to put a mirror on each one of those little panels until, and then hit a laser from where your speaker is.
At the 45-degree angle, yeah.
Yeah, from, you know, up to that thing, and then from the tweeter, and that will be where it is. And I don't know what that tells you, really. All right, anyways, Barney asked us last week about slower floating motion, computer-generated artificial look.
Okay, I have to ask, Austin, what does that mean?
What does that mean?
That's why I always use it as a quote, because that's how he described it. So I wanted to give you all the information I had.
Well, Lee and I were praying that you could inform us, because we weren't exactly sure what he was talking about.
Anyways, on his friend's new Ultra HD TV when watching House of Cards, he wanted to update it us that it happens on other content as well, including broadcast TV. CSI Cyber. Is that a show?
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Oh, really?
It's what's his face? It's Dawson's Creek. It's Dawson from Dawson's Creek. James Vanderbeek.
That guy has the longest face. Oh my God! It's like he got stretched out. Anyways, and the TV is an LG LED TV. Is that helping us at all? Because I don't know what that means. Slower floating. It's got to be that it's frame interpolation stuff.
That's something. What Lee and I thought. Yeah.
That's got to be what it is.
And they just don't let you turn quite all of it off.
Exactly. Yeah. Because I actually mentioned last week, I know from reading the CNET reviews, and there's others too, like Digital Trends and whatnot, when they do the reviews, they have noted that particularly a couple of years ago and last year, some of the Vizios had this thing where you could not entirely turn off the frame interpolation no matter what you did in the settings. And there were some LGs that did it too, including last year's OLEDs. You could never completely turn it off, which was like, for the people who cared about it, they're like, this is the fly in the ointment. Everything else about it looks fantastic, but you cannot completely turn off the de-judder processing. You can set it to zero, you can set it to off, it does not turn off. That was the problem. So he says it's an LG TV. I know there were some LG TVs that had that issue. So this is not making me think that I'm way off the mark here. I think he probably has one of the TVs where that was the problem.
Well, isn't House of Cards in 4K anyways? If he's got an Ultra HD TV, shouldn't he be able to get it in 4K and then he won't have to worry about this?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. Tell your friend to upgrade his bandwidth and stop watching crappy TV shows.
last week we questioned whether because the only thing you mentioned last week was House of Cards off of Netflix. So we're like, maybe it's just something to do with the stream. Maybe it's just that show. Yeah. But he's like, nah, other content shows it too. Yeah, so it probably is
what he's saying.
Yeah.
Anyways, this goes... He has a corner space where a 50-inch TV will fit, but nothing larger. He would like to get an OLED TV, but all the currently available models are a minimum of 55 inches. Do we know of any upcoming releases of 50-inch OLED TVs?
I'm not aware of any.
No. CES.
Yeah.
Come to us on my anniversary. 12th day of Christmas is always during CES, and that's when we'll know.
I mean, the good news is clearly the yields are improving and the prices are coming down. We've seen that very clearly from OLED. I mean, LG is the only one making OLEDs. Panasonic has one out, but they bought the panels from LG and then put their own software into it. So because the yields are improving and the prices are coming down, that makes it more likely that they will start to introduce more size options, because they've really stuck with 55 and 65, and then they've had a couple of like 77-inch ones that were like, you know, if you had all the money in the world, didn't have to ask how much they cost. There's a chance since things are improving, but I haven't heard anything concrete about there being a 50-inch. Maybe the curve will help. Maybe the curve will make it just small enough to fit. Maybe he's found the one reason to get a curved TV.
Still not good enough.
Still not going to work?
No, still not good enough. It's not a curve. Good reason for a curve.
There's only one reason for a curve. That is because you are literally sitting, like, you are sitting so close to it that it distorts if you don't have the curve. It's the IMAX effect. So he says if there's no 50-inch OLEDs on the way, well, there might be. We don't know. What do we think will be the very best 50-inch TV in 2016? Anything that, well, and I don't know what the very best would be. I'm sure those Samsungs are pretty dang awesome right now. That seems to be the consensus.
But, and Vizio. You know, Vizio has Vizio's really...
The M series is what their best is. R series, reference series.
Well, the reference series is their flagship, crazy $6,000 for 65 inches, which is the smallest size. And then the next size up is 120 inches. So, you know, it's for everybody.
There's a little boy size and a big boy size.
It's also $130,000 for the 120 inch. So good luck to you. But
it's also 120 inch flat panel.
Yes. Yes. Good luck bringing it into your house.
Hey, if you spend $130,000 on it, you're going to knock out a wall.
You know, build a house around it. But, yeah, I mean, they did not update their P series in 2015. So there is definitely a new P series on the way. And I am almost certain it will have HDR. And being that it's Vizio and being that supposedly there are chips that exist now that will be able to decode both HDR10 and Dolby Vision. So like I was saying on the HDR question earlier, it's like, it looks like we're probably going to have both formats. More TVs are going to probably support it. And if I were a betting person, I would say Vizio is definitely on top of that type of thing because they have been in the recent past. So I would say the previous P-Series had a 50-inch model. It was one of the earliest 4K available TVs. I would not be surprised in the least if in 2016 they have a new P-Series, has a 50-inch model that's HDR.
Do you know at the top of your head the hierarchy? It C-Series is their entry level, right?
It's E-Series is their entry.
E, and then C? E,
and then M.
And then M. Oh,
yeah,
and then what?
E, and then M, and then P, and then R.
I thought they had C-Series, no?
Not anymore, if they ever did. Yeah.
Oh, whatever. All right, so Clips, his last question is, Clips wrote about their Atmos speakers on their blog, and in one section they claim to have the only discrete two-way Dolby elevation speakers on the market for a much more dynamic, powerful, and realistic Dolby Atmos listening experience. Is that true? What, you think they're lying?
Word of?
It depends on your definition of some words.
Well, okay. Now, first of all, let's back this thing up, because he took that content, he took that a little bit out of context. So what this actually says is, how do Clips Reference Premiere Dolby Atmos enabled speakers work differently than old competitors' upfiring technology? So the question is, how are your upfiring speakers different than other people's upfiring speakers? And what they say is, with the control directivity and exceptional efficiency of our blah, blah, blah,
track
tricks, we are able... Yeah, we're able to meet the very stringent specifications just like everybody else, whatever, whatever. Because of this, Clips is able to offer the only discrete two-way Dolby Atmos elevation speaker on the market. Okay, so they're differentiating themselves from other people because first they have a horn, which is directional, which they have spent all their time in life trying to convince us that it's not. But now that they need it to be, it is, and therefore it's a bonus. Number two... that they're two-way rather than one-way, which is apparently what they think everybody else is.
Right. Well,
just not so true because what? I mean, how many coaxial or concentric speakers do we know exist out there?
Exactly. Atlantic Technology has a coaxial one. ELAC has a concentric one. Pioneer has a concentric one.
Those are all two ways. They have to be two ways by definition.
Those are all, yeah, they have a tweeter and a midwoofer. They happen to be concentric or coaxial. So are they saying that the word discrete, because that's the only thing
makes a difference.
If they're saying that the word discrete in this case means not coaxial,
Yeah.
which is an odd definition of the word discrete to me, because what is true about the Klipsch upward firing Atmos speakers is they're the only ones I've seen that have a separate tweeter and mid-range, and the tweeter is not in the middle of that mid-range driver. It looks like a traditional two-way bookshelf speaker that happens to have a 20-degree angle to it and fire up instead of forward. And that is true. They're the only ones who have that particular design. Now, Triad...
I think that's what they're trying to say here.
Yeah, yeah. Triad has a design where they have that little four-pack of tweeters.
Yeah.
But only one of those tweeters plays all the way up to 20 kilohertz, and the other three tweeters basically act together as a mid-range driver, which is an odd design. So that's not concentric or coaxial either. However, I guess that Klipsch could say that the word discrete is playing double duty, because in that Triad design, one tweeter plays from 20 kilohertz all the way down to like 200 hertz, and then right. the other three go from like 3,000 hertz down to 200 hertz. So they could say, well, we're the only ones that have like a full crossover between a separated tweeter and midwoofer, but that's putting a lot on that single word discrete.
Language is awesome. Oh, and his last part of this question is, what would make them sound more realistic? The fact that they told you so, and therefore you think it.
What I will say is they accept, according to the specifications, higher peak input power than any of the other ones that are on the market. Because even the KEF reference series one, which is another concentric design, I think the KEF one tops out at like 150 watts input, and this Klipsch can accept 200 watts, they say. So maybe they're like, it's more realistic because it can play louder.
Maybe.
It's more efficient. It's more efficient. It's horn loaded. It can accept more power. So it can probably play louder than the others. That's probably
true. Yeah, generally speaking, you know, I harp on this all the time, and everybody's trying to differentiate themselves for one reason or another.
Yeah.
And it really doesn't matter. When it comes down to it, if you're a good speaker designer, you're going to come up with a good sounding speaker no matter what design choices that you've used. You know, I've heard people harp on, oh, I don't like this type of driver. Like, to kill your mom? I mean, why? What happened? Because the driver itself is just a way of getting sound into the room. Now, it can't... I really have a hard time saying, you know, about paper cone woofers are not good. Like, how can you say that? Because there's some good ones and there's some bad ones, and you know, you can't just unilaterally decide that that's not the case. And that's what's happening here. We've got this horn loaded tweeter. We can accept more power. We have a mid range and a tweeter like a normal speaker, unlike these other weird speakers with a tweeter in the center or the four tweeters. Therefore, our stuff's going to be more realistic. And no. So, what would make them sound more realistic? Fairy dust and unicorn horns. I don't know.
If you bought 7 KEF reference series speakers and then decided you wanted to add some upward firing modules, do you really think you're going to suddenly buy Klipsch, or are you going to buy the ones that KEF sells that match the rest of your speakers in looks and sound and design and use the same drivers? So it's like, if you bought KEF, you're going to buy these. If you bought Pioneer, you're probably going to buy the Pioneer upward firing one. That's how most people handle something like this. That's my thought.
Yep. So, yeah. Jonathan discovered why his Denon was going into protection mode. It wasn't a loose wire. Are you sure?
Much like Lee, he didn't thoroughly check.
He didn't check.
Much like Lee.
So why? Lee never checked?
He never checked. He says it hasn't happened.
It just goes into protection mode every once in a while. He doesn't care.
He says it hasn't happened, and he did change the impedance setting thing because he had it set to the lower one, so he raised it to the higher one.
Oh, now we know why it's not happening. Not getting hot anymore.
So that it's not... it's not choking off all the power to his speakers. That might have had somebody still... What? Okay, guys, seriously. What is the resistance to checking the speaker wire connections?
It's such a pain. That's why. It's a pain. It's in the back of stuff. You got to go back there to pull it all out. It's a pain. Anyways, Jonathan's Denon is on a shelf in a closet, and it was pushed up against a side wall. The manual recommends at least 3 inches clearance, so he moved it 3 inches to the right, and it seems to have solved the problem.
So might have just moved the loose wire.
There you go. Could be. Now, it could be heat. Heat will send you into protection mode.
Yes.
But it also could have been that you just moved that thing, and now whatever was lying across the thing, whatever. No, doesn't matter.
I saw one guy on a forum who was complaining away, saying that I forget what brand of receiver he had, but he's like, I'm never going to buy this brand again. It overheats. It shuts off. And then he finally, like, people were begging him to show pictures of his setup. And he finally did. And he had it sitting on a high pile carpet.
Oh, Jesus.
Like, without anything below it. And I'm like, well, guess what? It can't ventilate itself. That's why it's overheating.
Yeah, I put well, I got all that gear out to put it to set up those speakers for the electrostatic speakers. I put it all in this little marble piece of mm-hmm. I have, you know, because it's on the carpet. I'm not gonna put it directly on the carpet. And I had the amp on the bottom, of course, because it looks better that way. Even though it's not the best way to do it, it looks better. Amps on the bottom.
All the heat's venting stack effect up into the bottom of the AV receiver. For the processor.
It's just a processor. Who cares? It's got nothing in there. The big empty box. So it's all full of air. So, yeah. Anyways, all right, so you fixed this problem. Jonathan has also has plenty of first-hand experience with a Yamaha digital sound projector last week. He felt Rob and Lee made it sound as though a digital sound projector wouldn't really be worth it unless you can adhere to the room setup guidelines described in Yamaha's manual. While he agrees with our statement that regular speakers and the AV receiver would sound better, he now knows that in person, since he actually has them. Well, he feels quite strongly that with a full speaker setup, it simply isn't an option. The digital sound projectors sound better than any other remaining option, even using heavily compromised placement and a setup.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, I can agree with that. Yeah.
Well, and he's had that thing since I recommended it to him.
Mm-hmm.
5-6 years ago. I mean, it was a really long time ago when I recommended that to him, and he got it, and he really likes it. So, you know, you're not going to convince him that it's not a good thing. And I am a big fan of even though the one digital sound projector, the second digital sound projector, which was one of their entry-level ones, was absolute garbage. But the good ones, the more expensive ones, the ones that I'm not trying to sell you for $350, only have 5 tweeters in the front. Those are excellent, and they do a fantastic job of bouncing sound around the room. That being said, it is nice that they also give you the option of using the phase thing, because when I set mine up, I set it up in a corner just to see how bad it would be. And in one side, there was a sort of an opening, so it was going to have a really hard time bouncing through that. And it was you could tell the difference. You could tell the difference, you know. And in a situation like this, too, especially if you've got a room and you're thinking of using acoustic panels, you're like, I can't use acoustic panels anymore because you can't bounce around. You can't bounce the sound you're trying to bounce around with acoustic panels in place. So you got to take your panels down as well.
Yeah, no, I think it was, you know, Lee and I were trying to play the balance of, like, it'll sound better than a cheapo sound bar. It'll sound better than your TV's built-in speakers, for 100% sure, regardless of the situation. But these things also cost like $1,600, right? So you're paying a lot more to get, yes, some better performance. But I mean, Jonathan doesn't disagree. You could take the same $1,600, buy 5 regular speakers and a Navy receiver for that amount of money, and that would sound better. So it is this combination of, you have to be in the situation where traditional speakers aren't an option. And you're like, look, I have to use a soundbar or something where all the speakers are up front. And then this is the best solution available. I agree with that. But it's hard to say that, oh, it's going to be, you know, compared to a $350 soundbar, it's worth spending $1,600. Or if you have the room where it's perfect, then separate speakers are still going to sound better. So it's like, I still think it's in this odd zone of, you have to have the situation where you've sort of got your hands tied and this is the form factor you need, and then it's the best of those, right?
Right.
But not like the best bar none.
Right. All right. He also sent us some before and after pictures of the room he's been putting together. All that's left to add are the seats he's ordered and some curtains, unless we think anything looks amiss. I looked at the after pictures. His room really came out nice.
Yeah. I know.
It looks really good.
Yeah.
He's got a couple of absorbers on the walls. He's got it's a real small room. I don't have the pictures open right now because they didn't open. I'm going to press the button. We're going to see what happens.
Yeah. Don't have the new computer yet.
I know. I don't. I wish I did. But,
but yeah, he's got acoustic panels on the front wall and the back wall. He's going to have curtains on both the left and right wall, because one curtain going over the entrance to the closet and one going over the windows. So he's going to have a good amount of, you know, absorbing some sound, not having just hard surfaces for things to reflect off of. He's got his ELAC speakers. He's got the surrounds nice and up high on some of the Yorkville stands. Not the exact ones I recommended, but actually I have the same ones he has with the triangular bases. But it gets them up high because they're like pro monitor stands. And then he's got SB1000 subs, which look so cute. Aren't those cute little cubes?
They are very cute little subs. I like how he's using the front one for a stand for his center channel.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's just kind of awesome. What's underneath that center channel? I'm trying to figure
several
that out.
Several mopads.
Is that what that is?
It's several mopads, yeah. It's not just one pair. There's multiples. So, yeah, his front SB1000, which is in the center of the front wall, is acting as the stand for his center speaker. And that's great. I'm all for that. It gets everything in the correct position. And that TV looks good, man.
It does.
It's one of those M-series, Vizios. That's a good-looking TV.
Yep. He's got a nice setup. I don't see anything that you need to do different, dude. I mean,
nah.
It looks like you got everything set up. So has he reported to us how he likes his ELAC speakers?
Yeah, he's said he's been very happy with them so far. So the only thing was when his Denon was shutting down, he was like, are these ELAC speakers too inefficient? And no, they are not. You just needed more air.
Apparently, or just to move your receiver so that you...
wiggle the wire.
Wiggle the wire. I don't see a absorber for the first reflection on the left wall, or I guess right wall there. I'm wondering...
The curtain's going to be going over that.
It's going to be going there. Okay.
So, you know. That's doing some.
No,
better than nothing.
Better than poking out with a sharp stick. Good job, Jonathan. Lastly, you notice a high-frequency buzzing sound coming from a surround speaker, but strictly with one local CBS affiliate station. Isn't that the same CSI, right?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
I'm starting to think. Conspiracy
it's
going
still
on
a, it's still a source issue.
It's a CBS, apparently. Was it? Were you watching that CSI Cyber? Was that what it was? Anyways, and only on certain contact from that one station. It's I'm telling you, it's CSI.
Maybe it is CSI Cyber, and they just put a buzzing in there so that it's constantly in your head. Like we're cyber.
They are trying to hack your brain. So, anyways, he says clearly it's just an issue with that one broadcast channel. But is there anything he could do? Is this the price of setting up an accurate system? You get to hear all the bad stuff really noticeably too. Well,
you could turn off the surround speakers when you watch CBS. That's about all.
You could do that. You could do that. Put in the stereo and then have it come around. That's a pain. You're not going to do that. Well, the answer to your last question, is this the price of setting up an accurate system? You get to hear the bad stuff really noticeably too. And the answer to that is yes. That is the price you pay. You will realize that there at some point, maybe you won't, depending on what kind of music you've been listening to. But I know that there's been CDs that I've loved since childhood. let's say high schoolhood, that you get your system set up, you're like, man, I haven't listened to this CD in forever. I'm totally going to listen to this. But you're like, oh, God, turn it off. Let's go listen to it in the car. Take it and put it in the car. Because it the difference is staggering. Staggering how bad it sounds. And that will happen to you. I guarantee that will happen to you. Now, as far as the CBS thing, you're kind of hosed on that one, dude.
Does sound like it's just that one broadcast, because he's like, it's not happening with anything else, like even other TV channels, right? So that's not your system's fault. It really isn't.
Yeah, that has something to do with your system. And that's happened to me before. There's been channels and stuff that you go to, and I remember when we first got my first HETV, there were certain channels I would go to, and it would screw up the aspect ratio every time you went to that station. It was like, you have to go and just for that one station, reset the aspect ratio, and it just used to drive me absolutely nuts.
But you know what? He said it's a local affiliate. I'm being genuine here. Write to them. And say there is a problem with your audio, because it's amazing. Like in TV, considering that 7,500 people decide what the entire United States watches, apparently, according to the Nielsen ratings, like one letter apparently represents several million people. So, you know, if you write, they'll be forced to believe that millions of other people are experiencing the same thing because they got one letter. You know, the math works out, right?
And we know you have the capability of writing to people. We're sure.
for Sirius, write to them, because they honestly might do something about it being a local affiliate, right? So
I did Nielsen one time. Yeah. That was back before I had the box. I had to fill it out on a
survey
piece of paper.
Yeah.
I like
your Wi-Fi
like...
fly got canceled. You're the reason, Tom.
I felt so. No, that was a long time ago. Hey, believe me, if I had been in there, I would have.
Hey, your one survey would have represented millions of people. So, you know.
They should have sent it to me then. I was so bitter. Anyways, I was bitter with a lot of those shows. I had a lot of shows get canceled. Speaking of which, we haven't talked about Jessica Jones. Did you guys talk about Jessica Jones last week?
No, we didn't. I've only watched three episodes. That's all I have time to see.
I binge-watched the crap out of that. I watched it over the weekend. I got back from camping on Wednesday. I watched an episode and a half after I got back and everybody went to go take naps. Oops, sorry. I went to go take naps, and I was like, I'm going to go take a nap in the home theater. And I watched an episode and a half of Jessica Jones. And then I watched like three more episodes that night, and I finished it. I think I finished it Friday or Saturday. I finished it Thursday night and Friday night, and I finished it up those two nights. Thursday, I was too full to drink any more beer, so I just watched Jessica Jones until 2 o'clock. Yeah, so any thoughts? Come on. Austin, have you watched it?
I haven't gotten to watching it yet, no.
None of it.
Our video file. Our video file is here. Our cinephile, dude.
Well, I already...
We have a podcast about, what's it called? We Watch Movies, that podcast about cyber terrorism.
Mm-hmm. We could, yeah. Well, I've got two podcasts I do work for, and I work. I'll get to it. I will watch.
I watched the whole thing. Okay.
How many episodes are there?
13.
10?
Just like
13.
Just like they're 13. It's just like Daredevil.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah, it could be. You're right. Yeah.
So, yeah, I know I'm right. I watched them all. Don't argue with me. No. So I thought it was pretty good. Just you could see, I got a lot of the references that I'm not sure everybody else is going to get, but David Tennant does a great job as the bad guy, and we will be talking more about that in the future. Who was that? That was loud.
Oh,
what's that?
I have no idea. I didn't hear anything of mine, but I already loved Kristen Ritter, of course, not just from Breaking Bad, but also from Don't Trust the Bee in Apartment 23, which sadly didn't last nearly as long as it should have, because that was actually a funny show. So she was already awesome, and I can't imagine Jessica Jones. I mean, I've only seen three episodes, but I can't imagine it working as well as it does without her in the lead role, because she brings a lot to it.
She does, for sure. There's no doubt about that. And I think most of the characters in there do a fantastic job of bringing their actors do a fantastic job of bringing their characters to life. There's a little problem with the writing to my mind. There's not enough super likable characters. Like, you need somebody to kind of root for. And Jessica Jones, as great as she is, she isn't super likable.
I liked her. Well,
I like her fine. I'm rooting for her and stuff like that, but she's certainly damaged. And that's part of the thing. But you want some more people in there who are not quite so messed up.
Everybody does seem kind of messed up in that show. That's true.
Yeah. there's some characters that later on in the show they get a little bit better. But for the most part, you're just like, there's some characters are like, oh, I hope you get killed. I'm really hoping that you get it, because I don't ever have to.
Like the entire cast of The Walking Dead. That's the only reason to watch, to see them all die, because they're all horrible.
Oh, at this point they are. Yeah. I'm liking the newest series, newest season. But anyways, so I will wait till you finish watching it. We'll give people some more time to catch up, but then we can talk specifically about. But yes, I've watched the whole thing, and now I've moved on to Amazon Prime. Has got the new series, The Man in the High Tower.
Yes.
About the alternate version of World War II thing, which I watched about 5 seconds of last night and went, I'm gonna watch Jurassic World instead. Which, honestly, I really thought I should have just stayed with The Man with the High Tower, because that movie was garbage. There's a lot of dinosaurs in it, but the whole time, you know what that's like? It's like the Mummy movie. The last one, the fourth one, it's the fourth one, right? With Jet Li in it. It's so much action, and there's no character development. So I'm like, I don't care if you people die, because I cannot remember your names. And I have no idea why you're
That's true. I have no idea what Chris Pratt's character's name was. I have no recollection whatsoever of his name.
He has a name.
I'm sure he
did. he's like the shark guy in that Deep Blue Sea thing. He like is like, I'm a badass with sharks. Now let's go get attacked and run away a bunch. I'm like the whole movie, I was like, oh, who are these people again? You know, really nothing. The whole reason we cared in the first Jurassic Park movie is because we got to know the characters. Hmm. We got to see their some of their flaws, some of their strengths. We got to understand their motivations. And here we are with these characters, and I don't know who they are, and I don't know what they're doing. I know it's like, oh, I don't want the kid to die because he's a kid, but you know what?
Well, Bryce Dallas Howard wanted to do a good job, and she wanted to do it while wearing her heels. So there, I know her motivation.
That's her motivation. Heels. The heel chick. Come on, Austin, pipe in here.
I did a whole episode about this. Yeah. I'm letting your opinion come out.
All right. So you have to tell me whether I'm right later. All right, Alan is an AV Rant success story. He auditioned several speakers as per our recommendation. He started at local stores where he heard Golden Ear, Klipsch, Totem, and Revel. He liked the Totem and Revel speakers, especially the $22,000 Salon 2s.
All right.
And was surprised how easily he ruled out the Golden Ear and Klipsch. And he said in this email, you know, even in this room that he'd never been in before, he was like, nope and nope. You know?
Well, I mean, I agree, and I've mentioned it several times. I think both Golden Ear and Klipsch have characteristic sounds to their speakers that I don't think they're aiming for linear. They don't claim to be aiming for linear. They have their characteristic sound, and apparently he doesn't care for it. But it doesn't mean other people won't, so it's worth hearing.
There you go.
For yourself.
He then ordered some Vipirion Varis Grand Towers and the Ascend Acoustic Sierra 2 bookshelf speakers. Given their price points compared to the store brands, he quickly decided that Internet Direct was the way he would go. And also, they wouldn't let him take those speakers home to test them in his house.
I think we'll get to that
in a second. Anyways, being able to directly compare the Vipirion and the Ascend speakers in his own room was critical. At first, he wasn't sure which ones he preferred, but then he used an AB speaker selector box so that he could instantly switch, and that was pivotal. And he decided that the Vipirion Varis Grand Towers, he says, sorry, Rob, for not preferring the Ascend Sierra 2s.
And Sierra 2s. No apology necessary whatsoever. I mean, you heard them for yourself. And I mean, the thing is, I think he would agree, based on his earlier comment that, like, before he did the direct AB instantly switching comparison, he wasn't even totally sure. I'm like, I think he would agree that if someone likes the Sierra 2s, they're not a crazy person. It took instantly switching between them for him to find a preference, and I'm super happy that he did, because that's the whole point. That's awesome.
Yeah. He then measured the frequency response of both speakers in his room using Room EQ Wizard, the HDMI output of his laptop, and a calibrated UMIC-1.
UMIC, I'm sure.
I'm sure it's supposed to be UMIC, but it's not. It's UMIC. Clearly. UMIK-1 USB microphone from Cross Spectrum Labs, again, based on our recommendation, and a setup that AV Rant recommended and was much easier to use in his old measurement setup that included an external sound card and mixing board. In this setup, the Vipirion speakers produce a flatter response, so he's very satisfied, and he knows that he almost certainly prefers a neutral sound. He says, the whole experience was eye-opening and fun, and he couldn't have done it without us. So, yay.
Yay! So that's just a story, no question, but it is the result of like putting everything we've suggested into practice and ultimately having peace of mind, because he will never question that he bought speakers that he likes and that he didn't miss out on something. You know, it's not like that. He knows what type of sound he prefers now, so if he ever does want to change speakers, he has a reference point to start from. It's all terrific stuff. I love it.
And now we know definitively that my speakers are better than yours.
It was interesting because he said that when he measured the setup with the Sierra 2s, that the measurements he got, the highs weren't as extended and not as flat.
Oh, really?
The thing about the Sierra 2s is that they have a very narrow vertical dispersion of that tweeter. Mm. It's if you take just the height of the tweeter itself, which is a ribbon, so it's a little taller than a regular dome. But if you just take the height of that tweeter, you only add about 10 degrees up and down where the sound stays the same. And outside of that vertical range, the sound does change. So it's not impossible that you have the speakers a little up or a little down. Which again, the whole point is what's going to work in your room, in your setup. Maybe there's no way to get them at the perfect height in his setup, which is totally understandable and fine. You know, so he's not going to buy all new furniture and seats just to accommodate the small vertical window of the Sierra 2 speakers. So yeah, it all adds up, and I'm really happy for him that he's happy that he got these results.
All right, Tony already has a SVS PB1000 is slightly more than 2,000 cubic foot room, and he's looking at a second sub. He was considering a PC2000 cylinder, mostly for the floor space reasons, but then he saw last week's blowout special of a batch of SB12 NSDs that SVS was selling. Mm-hmm. He missed the sale. They went quick. Yeah. But it has raised the question of whether a sealed sub would be able to integrate well with his ported PB1000. Yes, that'll be fine.
Yeah, good question. Because you know they do
seal shouldn't make any difference as far as it's just whether or not their frequency responses match up.
Yeah, I mean they do have, you know, if you were to measure them, you take them out into wide open field and measure them, they do have different responses, particularly in the lowest bass, because the sealed box is going to start rolling off a little higher but more gradually, whereas the ported box is going to remain flat to a lower frequency, but then drop off much more steeply. But both of them can reach down to 20 hertz. And when you're in a smaller room, because 2,000 cubic feet is, by any account, a small room.
Yeah.
So yeah. You see those type of frequency response slopes when you're starting to reach the upper limits, the upper output limits of the subs. I mean, that's what these frequency response measurements you're seeing. They're out in a wide open field and starting at like 95 dB. Right in that setting, and that's where you're seeing that response curve. When you take them into a much smaller room, you have all the room gain, the response is flat from either of them, because they can they easily have the headroom to get loud enough and extend all the way down. So yeah, I mean, your goal is to have similar extension, similar output capabilities, but keeping in mind how much output and extension do you really need for your room size. So in this setting with a small room, no problem.
Isn't NSD the one that was
replaced by the 2000 series.
The 2000. So basically, that's like a sealed, it's a slightly less powerful SB2000 box.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's fine. Second, he seems to recall us mentioning something about new SVS products. Do we have any more info on that? I don't know, Austin. Do we have any more info on that?
Well, we should pretty soon. We do have an interview with Gary Yakubian coming up within about 3 or 4 weeks or so, probably.
We are definitely working on that. We want that to happen very, very much, and they want it to happen too. So we don't want to promise, because obviously sometimes plans fall through, but that's the idea, and it's not for us to say. They want to make announcements. So
yeah, they have some announcements to make. They have reached out to us to interview Gary again, which means he did say he had a good time last time.
Yeah.
So hopefully you have a good time this time. And we're going to interview him hopefully in a couple of weeks here, 2-3 weeks, and we'll get some information out of them and pass it along to you as soon as we can. There you go. You'll hear it here hopefully first. Or ish. Whatever.
You'll hear it here.
You'll hear it somehow, here. I'll just go with that. Jacob is looking to upgrade his 10-year-old Denon AVR 1508 to a Denon AVR S910W. Are we okay with the 910, or would we prefer another receiver? His max budget is 6 bones. Isn't the 910 like a really entry level?
No, it's the highest end of the non-X series. Let's put it that way, right?
Okay.
So the question is simply, are you buying it brand new, or are you willing to look at a refurbished unit from Accessories for Less, or even a refurbished unit from Amazon, because they're starting to sell refurbished units directly from the manufacturers now too. So If you're buying it brand new, the S910 is $579 on Amazon, which obviously is reaching his $600 budget. Couldn't go to a higher model than that. But over at Accessories for Less, first of all, the S910 is only $399 refurbished, so that's definitely doable. But there's the X2200, which sells for $499 refurbished. And actually, that's both at Amazon and Accessories for Less, so take your pick. $499 refurbished for the X2200. The X2200 and the S910 are almost identical, except that the X2200 has Malt EQ XT rather than just standard Malt EQ. And it had something else with Zone 2 that the S910 had that I can't recall offhand. Not a huge amount of difference between the two of them. But since you could get a refurbished X2200 for less than a brand new S910, I would consider it because you're getting the better version of Odyssey. That's really the main reason.
I'd get the better version of Odyssey.
Yeah.
Just straight up.
Yep.
Yeah. Secondly, he wants to know, SuperCube 4000, Martin Logan Dynamo 700W, or SVS PC 2000, or some other sub in the $500 to $800 range.
Mm-hmm. Well, out of those three...
Yeah. I mean, which one do you think we're going to say?
I don't know. But not just because... Not just because the SuperCube 4000 is an 8-inch driver in a teeny tiny little cube with two passive 8-inch radiators. And its rated frequency response, I think, is down to 28. Right?
Yeah.
The Martin Logan Dynamo 700 is a 10-inch driver in a slightly bigger box than the 4000, and it's rated down to, I think it was 24. The PC 2000 is this huge cylinder with a 12-inch driver and a 500-watt amp that's rated down to 18 hertz. And none of them, I mean, thankfully, none of these companies really lie on their spec sheets. They're not like some of the companies that...
28, listen, if you were going to lie, 28 would not be the number that you would lie with.
Yeah.
You can look at that and say, same thing with 24 for Martin Logan. Because if you're gonna lie, you're gonna.
I'm not 100% on those numbers, but I know none of them were digging below 20, other than the PC 2000. That's the way to go if you're getting a single sub. However, $500 to $800, and I don't know his room size.
What is your room size?
Yeah, the pictures, I couldn't see his full room. It doesn't look huge, but we really can't see. We're only seeing the front wall. I'm just thinking he could get a pair of HSU STF2s within that budget. And if it's a smaller to medium-sized room...
Those only are down to 25, though, right?
They are down to 25, but you're getting a pair of them, you know?
That is true.
There's big benefits to having a pair of subs. And it's not like the STF2s are bad-sounding in any stretch, you know?
Oh, yeah. This looks like a bedroom.
I know. So
nobody has that size furniture in a living room.
Exactly. However,
There's a fireplace to the left of it.
See, if the pictures are we have no idea, and it's actually a huge open space, I'll still mention HSU because their VTF 3 Mark V or their ULS 15 Mark II, both of which are big 15-inch subwoofers. Both of those are under $800. So if what you need
seems like he's going for a small footprint.
I know. But if what you need is crazy output, there's an option there too. So all I'm saying is the room is going to make a big difference here. Because if you need crazy loud output, there's another option in the HSU, big, gigantic ones, although it won't fit your footprint size. Or if it's a smaller to medium-sized room, you could get a pair of subs within that price range. It's tempting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Lastly, he bought a pair of DefTech Studio Monitor 45 bookshelf speakers for his front left right. He really enjoys them, but sometimes has difficulty understanding dialogue from what looks to be the smallest center channel ever made by man. Okay, we don't know what it is. It's about 6 inches wide, so... We now know why. He'd like to upgrade his center and surrounds to match the DefTech speakers, but in terms of physical space, the Pro Center 2000 is the largest center in DefTech's lineup that will fit. Do we think it's a good idea? Yes.
Yeah, it uses identical drivers.
Yeah. In fact, I think DefTech doesn't really seem to have that many drivers. Because I looked at some of their other ones that are bigger. Mm-hmm. And they use the same drivers too. Yeah. Some of them, they're just bigger, and they have like passive radiators on top because you need that in the center channel. But yeah, definitely, it's the same drivers. So if you know, I would think that they would probably timbre match pretty well.
Yeah, I'm guessing it's actually the depth of the speaker that's of most concern.
That's what I'm thinking too. Yeah.
Yeah, because the next one up is actually shorter, but it's wider, but it's much deeper.
Yeah, yeah, it's the one with the passive radiator on the top.
Yeah, so I mean, the problem was, because I would say if this was another brand, because DefTech likes to put these passive radiators on the tops of their center speakers, because other brands, you could actually get a big center speaker and then actually put your TV on top of it.
Yeah, but you can't do that when it's got passive radiator.
But you can't do it with a passive radiator on the top of the thing, so I think the ProCenter 2000 is probably the best option that you have here, and I don't expect it to be any kind of big letdown or anything like that. So, yeah.
You'll be able to hear stuff for sure.
It'll improve on what you have. I can almost guarantee that.
Yeah, I don't have any idea how much those cost anyways. Joseph is from Facebook, posted them on Facebook. He wants to EQ two subs, which would we recommend more highly, the Mini DSP 2x4 or the Behringer 1124 Feedback Destroyer. Are there any real advantages of one over the other? Well, everybody seems to be shifting towards the Mini DSP because, number one, is that doesn't necessarily have DRAC. You have to buy the ones with DRAC in it, right?
Correct, yeah. The one he's talking about is the $100 unit. It does not have DRAC. It's
But
it's
you can plug it directly into your computer and then download the stuff that you need from Room EQ Wizard, and it's seamless. And unless Behringer has come up with some solution that's like that.
There
I'm
is a way to plug the Behringer 1124 into the computer.
But it is not as easy. Yes, that's right. It is not as easy as this. And this is why everybody's moving to Mini DSP, because Behringer was such a ginormous, like, everybody who did it was like, oh yeah, it made a huge difference. It took me 17 days and I went to college for a semester. You know what I mean? It was such a pain to work with, and it works. It's a parametric EQ.
It's a parametric EQ. Yeah.
But this is, it's just a lot easier. So for ease of use alone, I'm going Mini DSP, because what will happen if you're not super duper into this, Joseph, you get that Behringer Feedback Destroyer, you start fiddling with it, and then you'll go, man, I got time for this crap. And then that's it.
Well, on top of that, also the Mini DSP is smaller, so it's just easier to place somewhere. But on top of that, the Mini DSP has like full fur filters if you want to. You can get into timing, you can get into adjusting crossovers, with the slope of the crossover, all that type of stuff. It's more programmable. So the Feedback Destroyer has a limited number of parametric filters. Ray's chiming in here saying that it actually has greater resolution in the Behringer Feedback Destroyer. I guess because it's like fully variable, right? It's
Behringer is, or the other one?
Yeah, the Behringer is. It's 100% variable. But at the same time, it doesn't do quite as much as the Mini DSP. So, I mean, in terms of integrating it, you know, I agree with Tom. I think the Mini DSP is the way to go. All right, Ray's saying that the BFD, the Behringer Feedback Destroyer, also can set multiple memories. So if you want to have multiple setups, rather than downloading them and uploading them to your laptop.
Yes, because it was so much fun to do it the first time around. Let's do it again. Let's do it again for music.
Well, I mean, you know, it's good.
And let's just do it again for SACD. And let's do it again for kids' movies. And let's do a nighttime mode. Oh, we'll have a nighttime mode too, where I take this thing and throw it out the window and go buy a PSP.
Yeah. Asking which one would I choose more highly. I'd go with the Mini DSP personally. I think it's the way to go.
I'm so super lazy. There's just no way that's happening. Like, I can't be bothered half the time to run Odyssey again. I'm like, I moved to speaker.
Yeah.
It's close enough. Way over there. The speakers are heavy. Jason asked before about audio dropouts and tracks restarting with SACD on his Oppo. He has an update. According to Oppo, because we told him to contact him, right?
Mm-hmm.
It was an HDMI handshake issue, which was not HDMI CC related. So still, HDMI sucks. And apparently, the track restarting is supposed to happen according to the reply he got from Oppo. Quote, SACD will go back to the beginning of the track when the player is switching between DSD and PCM output and vice versa based on the HDMI handshakes. That's what it was. So how do you stop it?
Well, their basic advice was whatever you have on when you start listening, leave everything on, because the instant you turn off another device, so you turn off your TV or you do anything like that, it doesn't do handshake. And then SACD says, hey, let's start from the beginning again, because obviously that's what you wanted to do when you turned off your display because you didn't need to see the track list anymore, right? Clearly, that must be what you wanted. So yeah, they're like, if everything is off, leave it off. Don't turn anything on, or it'll re-handshake. If everything's on, leave it on.
That is exactly, you know, because I sometimes watch, or I'll turn on music and hear when I'm writing, and I don't want to burn out my projector bulb just showing the menu on the screen, so I'll turn the projector off, and it does that to me. Now, it does. I'm not usually listening to SACD, so it doesn't restart the track, but I'll be watching Blu-rays and stuff like that, and it you know, go through the whole handshake thing, and it's a big deal, and then it finally it cuts back in, and it's fine. I never really thought about it, but yeah. That makes sense. Scott has heard us discussing light output for projectors in rooms with some ambient light. He has the Epson 3500 rated at 2500 lumens and wants to set people's minds at ease. He says that even with some lights on in the room, he still has it in cinema mode in the low lamp setting, and it remains perfectly watchable. He also had all the lights on this theater and simply put the projector into living room mode. The image looked brighter than the Sony flat panel in his room upstairs, and while black levels were obviously washed out, the image was still fine to watch. So, Scott, thank you for that, because that's a
Tom
really good
agrees.
Thing for us to pass along. I do agree.
Yeah, and he's got a pretty good, I think it's a 120-inch screen that he's got. It's certainly not a small screen that he has, I know. And it's not like super high gain or anything, you know, it's your regular 1.2 gain screen. So yeah, for the people who have been worried that they need 4,000 or 5,000 lumens, like some of the new models that have come out, it's like, no, like we've mentioned, I think one of the questions I know was specifically about the Epson 5030, which is rated at 2,400 lumens and can actually get up to that in some modes. Yeah, it's plenty bright. You'll be okay.
Overthinks these things. Carl, what was the HDTV over the air tuner DVR projectors we've recommended before the Hop Hog is the one I use for the Xbox One, and they make one that's not Xbox One specific,
right? Yeah.
The Channel Master, we've talked about here before. TiVo makes whatever it is.
Yeah, they had the TiVo Romeo OTA, but they're not making that anymore. They've replaced all the Romeo models with their new TiVo Bolt model. So it's now $299, which includes 1 year of TiVo service, but then you're on month-to-month or year or have to buy a lifetime pass after that. Got four tuners, though, in the Bolt.
And what is this, HD Home Run Network Tuners? That's two tuners. I've never heard of that.
Yeah, so the HD Home Runs are cool, particularly if you're using a home theater PC. That's where most people are using those, because it actually connects to your network router. That's where it sits in the signal chain. So it's taking the external antenna, it's a tuner, but then it has an Ethernet connection or a Wi-Fi connection, not an HDMI connection that would go out to your TV. So it sits on your network, and then anything that can access the network can now access that tuner. So you will need a separate playback device, but that could be like a Raspberry Pi with XBMC running on it, Kodi running on it.
$5.
$5 now. Yeah. So, or if you have a home theater PC or whatever. So the HD Home Runs are an interesting alternative, because not everyone thinks of them right away. But if you have any sort of network player, they're totally a way you can do it for $100. They're not bad. Yeah.
Toby just replaced his old DAK subwoofer with the SVS PB1000, is now considering going full SVS with tower center surrounds and a second PB1000. What do we think of SVS's non-subwoofer speakers? We think that people have heard them, have liked them a lot.
Think you can try them in your house for 45 days and send them back for free if they don't float your boat.
Yeah, the last time I heard them, it was their mid-level ones, I think.
Oh, and back in the show before they brought in the new Ultra series and the Prime series. Yeah, they had their
before the Primes, and when
they had like an S series and an M series, wasn't that it?
Yeah, something like that. It was the one. Yeah, the thing I thought of them was that they're a lot bigger than I thought they were going to look. But then again, I was used to that from SVS. So, yeah.
I think that was before Gary even joined the company, though, right? I think I think it precedes Gary.
That precedes Gary.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So those were much older models.
So, yeah.
You
try them for yourself and let us know what you think.
Yeah, there is nothing about their design in any way that's telling me to stay away from them. Certainly not. I love their center channel design because it's a good design that isn't often seen like at the Prime Center's price point. I would recommend for anybody who's going to do this, as long as you're able to float it on your credit card for some small amount of time, like Aperion pays shipping both ways too, right? Yes. So at the very least, bring in Aperion and SVS so that you can do at least one comparison. Send them back, because you can send them back for free, which everyone's decided not to keep. Because at least do one comparison, since it's free to do it.
Michael. First up, Michael resolved his issues with his Denon remote, where nothing but the power button was working. I'm really embarrassed. he just needed new batteries. So I don't know why none of us thought to say that, but it didn't cross my mind that batteries.
As soon as he said that, one of my friends who bought one of the Harmony 650 remotes, which I believe takes four AA or AAA batteries or something like that. I think it's AAA batteries, but I know it's four of them. He was saying, I'm having problems with this thing, like the light's not coming on or some of the buttons aren't responsive or whatever. And he was like, I just changed the batteries because I actually did suggest that. But he had bought some like super cheap generic batteries, like the, you know, super bulk ones from wherever. And he got like a pack of Duracells, put them in there, and the robot worked fine.
Yeah.
So surprisingly, batteries can actually make a difference in your remote.
Who would have thought?
It wasn't until he mentioned it, though, that it even crossed my mind. You're right.
Didn't cross my mind either.
It's like the loose speaker wire. You never want to like consider. It's the simplest thing.
Jonathan.
And Lee.
He sometimes has power outages, and when he does, his Denon AVR 1912 loses some settings. He likes to manually increase the subwoofer trim level to -2, but the power outage sends it back down to -6 dB where AutoSee set it. He also loses the list of favorites, internet radio stations, and network media sources that normally show up when he uses net USB input. Is there any way to prevent the 1912 from losing these settings every time there's a blackout? How is he changing the trim level on that subwoofer? Because some of the newer Denons, I don't know about the 1912, you can change it on the fly.
Right.
But that's not really changing it. Like, you have to go into the settings and change it there, like with the test tone. Mm-hmm. And if you're doing it there, it should stick. It should stay. It shouldn't go. It shouldn't change it back.
Yeah. I know, when you run Odyssey, of course, it saves Odyssey's settings, because there's usually a way to restore what Odyssey set it. Like if you do make some manual changes, there's usually a way to restore it back. So I wonder if it's simply that the only settings it is saving in memory somewhere are the Odyssey settings, and that's why it's going back there. That's not impossible, but I'm also not certain that is the case. I don't know. I honestly don't know. I mean, losing the favorites.
There's a settings lock, right? There's a settings lock. That's the first thing I would do is change everything and then click on the settings lock. Because believe me, I've done it in this house because my kids can change some settings.
Yeah.
Like with the power of their minds, they can do it. So I have to always lock my stuff down.
Ah, that's a good call. Yeah. I know that when it comes to the favorites and internet radio stations, I've had that problem too if I've ever had a power outage or just unplugged it without powering down properly or something like that. One other side of that, though, is that since those are network related, I'm betting when the power goes out that your router goes out too, right? And typically when you reboot a router like that, like unplug it and plug it back in, it assigns new IP addresses to all the devices that connect to it, right?
Yes.
And that's usually why you lose all of your network media sources in particular, because you had one IP address in memory and now the IP addresses don't match because your router got reset during the power outage too. Honestly, the solution, of course, to all of these things are battery backups on things so that when the power goes out, you don't actually lose power to those devices. I love having it on my router because it keeps my internet going when the power is out.
Yeah.
I don't know if there's a way to...
Yeah, because even with the battery backups, usually there's it flicks in the...
Yeah.
You know, sometimes it'll power off anyway. So, lastly, this question says, how does he turn on HDMI CC?
Oh, I'm sorry. It should be off. Yeah, it should be off.
It's annoying him as it was a fault to an unwanted source if that device is turned on.
Thank you, HDMI CC.
Exactly what it does. Thank you. You suck.
So, yeah, he has the AVR 1912. I looked through the manual. The particular way to get to it in his is you go to menu, the main menu. You go to the system settings. Under there, you go to the HDMI setup. And then there is something called HDMI control.
Yep.
And you have to turn that off. That is the pathway in this particular menu setting. I mean, I don't blame anyone for having difficulty finding these things because it's not always under an intuitive name. They're not all the same. You know, it's like you're thinking...
Fun setting.
Yeah, fun link, yeah.
Fun link. Because it's fun to have things randomly happen for no apparent reason and to make you think that your device is possessed.
No, I mean, I've seen it. I've seen it under miscellaneous on some. I've seen it under network setup on some. Like yep. You know, they
network
all over
setup
the place,
makes sense.
So.
Yeah, they'll do it all.
But here it's system setup and HDMI setup. That's what you're going through, and then HDMI control because it doesn't say HDMI CEC. It says HDMI control.
Or any net. AnyNet's one, right? Isn't that one? Oh, for
Samsung.
Samsung, right?
AnyNet Plus. Not and just Sony, AnyNet Plus.
Is it Sony? It's probably Sony Control or something like that.
That's
right?
BraviaLink.
BraviaLink. That makes more sense.
And Panasonic is Viera Link. I like Onkyo's RIHD because that's intuitive. That sure sounds like HDMI CEC. It sounds exactly like it.
Yeah. All right. We've got two questions left, one from John and one from David. We're going to have to skip you guys.
And a bunch that came in today, actually, and like
yeah,
late
we
last
got,
night.
We did get a bunch today, so unfortunately.
Several.
That's an issue.
So but, not to worry. If you sent it late last night, being Sunday, obviously if you're listening to the audio-only version of this episode, it won't make sense saying last night. So if you sent it in late on Sunday or on Monday when we record the show, we will get to you next week. Do not worry yet.
But if you have a question that's plaguing you about your home theater or your AV or life in general, you can email us. Like, I'm just feeling blue right now. Really? Oh, sorry.
Feel better.
Uncomfortable silence.
Buy another sub. Buy another sub.
You know, if you want to feel better about yourself, you can watch Jessica Jones because her life sucks. There you go. Anyhow, you can always ask us a question at rob@avrant.com, tom@avrant.com, and question, which is Austin, our producer at avrant.com. Austin does have his own podcast called We Watch Movies, and in that podcast, what do you guys talk about again, Austin? I can't remember.
No, I don't have a thing ready. It's your thing to make up things. I'm just going to say we talk about movies.
I'm saying sweater vests. It's all about
sweater vests.
It's about
how to
time
make
of year.
How to make your own, how to find the best deals. It's comprehensive.
How to match them with your eyes.
And I want to thank Austin. I want to thank Austin for allowing Tom and I to have a word in edgewise this podcast.
Yeah, you know,
he's just been talking our ear off this whole time.
Well, I was like so excited. We're like, let's talk about Jurassic World, and he's like, all right, let's talk about Jessica Jones. I haven't watched it. Let's talk about Jurassic World. No, I'm not gonna talk about that either. What, Austin? Throw your softballs over here.
I mostly agree with Jurassic World.
All
there's
right.
A lot of action that's boring anyway.
And what were their names, man? What were
I
their
don't
names?
Know. I can't remember their names. We talked for like an hour and a half about these people. I don't remember their names.
Little kid, big kid, chick with heels, guy from Guardians of the Galaxy.
That's right.
And
the guy from
Kingpin.
And Kingpin, that's right. With hair.
Kingpin was there. With hair.
With hair.
Weird.
And Jimmy Fallon. for like a second.
Oh yeah, dude. Oh,
that took me out of the movie.
Only person I can remember.
That took me right out of it.
Valid.
And hey, they invented transparent aluminum in this alternate universe.
Apparently, so, you know, yeah.
Good for them. Good on them. They watch Star
they
Trek.
They have that. Don't they have that? They've had that. We have that. We just, they don't make it. I know something. I read something about that. I don't remember. Anyways, to go to the website, www.avrant.com. You can leave a comment there. You can go to facebook.com/avrantpodcast, and we will pick up your question there and bring it to the podcast, where we usually answer it there as well, but then, yeah, sometimes it just ends up here as well. What else? Did I already say the Twitter? At First Reflect,
I don't think so.
Rob at avrant underscore Tom for me, and at Austin Pond for our producer, Austin. We want to thank once again our listeners of the week. We have Lior, Alan, Toby, and Diego. They went to www.avrant.com, clipped on the Buy Us a Cup of Coffee link, and left a PayPal donation. Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Yes, thank you, guys. It is hugely appreciated.
It is. And believe me, we will put that money to good use to do stuff like maintain our web hosting, which is somehow constantly running out of bandwidth. I have no idea why. How are we running out of bandwidth?
Someone is just downloading the whole website over and over and over again.
It's got to be what it is. It's really bizarre. Anyways, for AV Rants, I'm Tom Mantry.
And I'm Rob H.
And I'm Austin Pond. Now go out and listen to something.
Look at that. Austin's at the end. Very excited about that. Okay. For the after party, guys, it'll be starting momentarily.